Welcome back to Real Community Talks. This is a bit of a different episode this week. Normally, we come out with guests. If you haven't checked it out already, we are in season 2 of Real Community Talks. And I thought I'd change it up this week. Instead of just hearing from another guest, I thought we'd do another chat with Matt where we get to sit with myself, the host of Real Community Talks, and get to hear some words, some opinions on some stuff, some advice, all that kind of stuff. But normally I'm asking the questions and I'm talking to the guests. But this time I want to share some words of wisdom with you. For those of you that don't know, often I am invited to speak at places, whether it's high schools, whether it's, community centers, whether it's at church to my youth group. And lately I've been taking some opportunities where I've just been able to do some motivational talks. And recently I did a talk at my local community center, Malton Community Center, shout out MCC, where I used to be the youth worker for 2 years. Some of you guys know that backstory. I was asked to talk about my come up and my process and give a bunch of youth some advice about what that looks like. And I started writing this talk and I was like, okay, which route should I go? Should I rehash one of my other talks? Maybe there's going to be kids there that weren't at the first talk at Lincoln. And I just started having this overwhelming, crippling fear as time was going on and as like the deadline was coming to like finish it. And I was just stressing out, filled with anxiety. And then I thought for a second, I said, maybe I'm not supposed to talk about a specific topic. Maybe the thing that I need to talk about is this process that I'm going through. And a lot of times lately when I've been writing my sermons, preaching to my youth at church, they've been birthed out of something I've been going through that week. And I always say that I feel like you have more powerful of a message when you're speaking from experience and it's something that you've gone through and something that, you vividly lived through. Because I'm not just speaking colorful words. I'm not just speaking things that sound great, but because I've actually gone through that process myself. And I said, it would be more powerful if I talked about how I dealt with my anxiety preparing for this talk and make that the talk itself. What I wanted to share with you guys is that even though I'm a podcast host, even though I get asked to talk at many places, even though I was the valedictorian, I've spoken to people and hundreds of people in big crowds. I've spoken to big, organizations and people, delivered presentations, went to, high schools and delivered talks. Had the mayor of Mississauga on my podcast, even though in spite of all those things, Matt De Silva struggles with anxiety, struggles with crippling fear just as he's about to go into a big meeting or a big talk. Because I think part of that is good. I think anxiety can be healthy to an extent. Hear me out. I feel like if you are worried about your performance and how you're going to do, I think that shows that you care and that you don't want to come unprepared. However, oftentimes we can let that anxiety spiral so far to the point where we don't actually want to do things, to the point where I've actually said no to opportunities, not because I just, they weren't good. It's just because I was so fearful that I wouldn't be able to deliver. And out of this birthed this talk called Annihilating Anxiety. Shout out to Shannon Hayatali for co-helping me or co-writing this talk with me. It was actually birthed out of a conversation that we were having about how we both deal with anxiety. And I wanted to give you guys something practical and not just, speak something just whack, but actually give you practical tips and tools that we both thought can be used to deal with anxiety. This talk is going to go through the 6 S's of anxiety. Number one, the first thing in dealing with anxiety is sleep. Cut yourself off from the point of spiraling. I cannot stress enough how important this one is. A lot of times when I've stressed about a talk and my head is going in circles and I'm thinking about what people are going to think and how the outcome's going to, unfold, I'm just not really helping myself out because I'm allowing myself to go down a rabbit hole that I'm not able to get out of. And sometimes the best thing that I did for myself was legit turn off everything, go to my bed, wake up, get a good sleep, and tackle it the next day. And I think you need to allow yourself that distance to come back to whatever you're doing with fresh eyes. Like, sometimes, I don't know if you've ever written essays, if you guys are in school, but you know, you write it till like 4 a.m. and then you come back the next morning, you see all these spelling and grammatical errors and mistakes. It's because you've allowed yourself an opportunity to come back with a different mindset, a rested brain. And when you're running on that overdrive mode and you're stressing, how much quality content are you really able to put out? Side note, if my head is glistening right now, our AC is off. I'm having anxiety. No, I'm joking. Our AC is off. It's not working. So don't judge me. Allow me. Point number two, sharing and self-expression. So this is a little bit twofold. So when you're having anxiety, or when I've had anxiety, one thing that I found was very helpful was just legitimately unpacking and processing those thoughts in my head with people who I actually trust, and not just anyone, but people who can actually give me wise counsel. One thing that I often do with my mom is legit sit down with her for hours and just unpack about what I'm thinking, my day, some of my future plans. And a lot of the times I've realized, and she's told me, that she's actually just sat there, offered a little 1-2 thing, but let me ramble on. And oftentimes when I ramble on, but I have that outlet or that avenue to unpack those thoughts, I end up solving the problem myself. But it's finding that avenue, finding that person, finding that outlet that you're able to share those details, maybe sometimes confidential things, a vulnerability, a moment of vulnerability where you can just be you and just be real, that you kind of solve that problem yourself. You actually get those thoughts out of your head. I think there is a purpose to bringing your thoughts to reality, whether it's through recording yourself and hearing it back, or the next point, which is self-expression, drawing a picture. I remember one time, my mom had us three boys in the house, right? What's going on in your brain right now? Draw it in a picture. And like, it was actually pretty crazy what we actually came up with, but we were able to visualize sometimes all of that information that kind of just gets legged up in your brain and just put it out and express it into something. So whether that's art, whether that's sport, whether that's cooking, whether that's you literally legit just wanting to go to the batting cages and hit some baseballs, whatever you do to self-express, you find that thing and express yourself. Allow those thoughts to be unpacked and processed. So with a person and expressing through how you like to communicate and process that. Point three, self-care. What do you do for fun and how do you take care of yourself? And I'm not just talking about, okay, you know, I think it's important taking care of your, you know, proper hygiene and getting a haircut and, you know, getting that fresh, shout out to Frosty Fades, taking care of yourself. But what do you do for fun outside of your direct purpose that has nothing to do with it and is simply maybe not even related? Like, one thing my pastor always talks about to me is, like, he loves flying RC planes and riding motorcycles. And like, you'd think those things aren't synonymous with being a pastor. I mean, not that you have to do certain things just because you're a pastor, but those have nothing to do with his calling or his purpose. Those are just things he loves to do recreationally and he enjoys it. So we talked about going to sleep sometimes when we're having that anxiety. I think it's also important to sometimes switch up what you're doing and do something fun, so you allow your brain just to be jogged back into a different mode. Instead of stressing out, do something that's going to help relieve that stress and something that's going to make you happy and make you feel uplifted and just have a different mindset instead of just stressing out. It's important that you make sure that you take care of you and value you, because circumstances are going to change. They will always change, but you need to always have your back. And one thing that I've been doing lately is being super selfish with my time and what I do. A lot of people kind of getting at me because I haven't been replying in the DMs and I haven't been posting as much, but my mental health, my focus, my time and my efforts, I need to make sure that I'm taking care of me first before I even go out to take care of others. And I know that sounds a little weird, especially for someone who, you know, pours out his life for people, but how can I offer help to people, and not just help, quality help to people, if I'm not taking care of myself first? Next point, seeing others as insight for inspiration. Stop trying to reinvent the wheel when there's people who have already taken this pathway or have already done it before and you can actually gain wisdom from them. Not that I'm saying that you can just be mentored digitally, like physically, but we have a plethora, we have a wide range of content online, which is not all good, don't get me wrong, but a wide range of data and content and people who have walked this walk, maybe have been in the same place as you, maybe you don't even have the similar situation as you had, but have gone through things and have a proven track record of how they've come out of those situations. Why try to reinvent a way to get out of the anxiety when you can just simply watch a talk? Sometimes I'll watch a sermon. Sometimes I'll watch a motivational talk that allows me to hear how someone else who's walked this earth, who's lived real life, process their own stress, process their own anxiety, and how they got themselves out of that. And I think that is so important, because one thing that I love, and if you guys remember from episode one, Jonathan says, a fool learns from his own mistakes. A wise person learns from the mistakes of others. If someone's already done it, why be foolish and try to, you know, be prideful and deal with it on yourself? Look at what people have done. Take some principles from what they've, you know, those steps that they've taken in those situations. Jumble all that together, pick your best of what you want to do out of that, and apply it to you. I don't think that I have to just talk to people who've been through the same fears as me, who have the same type of anxiety as me. No, talk to someone who's maybe even stressing out about a totally different thing than you, and see if those principles can be applicable to you, because oftentimes they will be. Next point, setting small, realistic goals. So this is making sure that you are being strategic about how you manage your time and effort. I think one thing about me that stresses me out is I put everything on my to-do list and I want to get everything done in one day so that I have all of this free time that I don't have to do everything else. And I have anxiety because when I used to be a youth worker and my to-do list had 10 things on it and I only finished 3 and I went home, I felt so weird. I felt so unaccomplished. I felt like, you know, my time was running out. But oftentimes what happens is when we try to do all of those things on the to-do list and finish them, like I said, are we really effectively completing those tasks? Are we really putting care into that? Or are we just trying to finish it so we don't have to have the stress about doing work down to the wire, right? So I think we need to be realistic with ourselves. And one thing that I've been doing now is setting priorities on my to-do list. So if I put 10 things, I star the things that are priorities. Maybe out of that 10, 4 things I need to get done today, 2 things maybe I can start working on today, but I don't have to finish. And maybe, you know, another 2-3 things I can actually set in my calendar, you know, do this, do that. Breaking them up, chunking them up so that you're not trying to finish everything in one day, but that you're spreading out your efforts and you're effective. One thing that I've been really struggling with and trying to do with the podcast is editing, not all in one day, but throughout the week. And the thing about me is I get so passionate and I want to finish the episode right away, but it would be more profitable to me if I just did 20 minutes on a Monday, 20 minutes on a Tuesday, finish it on the Wednesday, and do all of those things spread out. That allows me to manage my time better for the other things in my life, but it also allows me to not stress out down to the wire and work literally sometimes 8 hours just to get a podcast episode out. So set those small realistic goals, chunk it up, and then actually plan out how you're going to tackle those things. Last point, selectivity within your sphere. This is so important. I think there's 2 sides to this. One, like I said in the other point before, when you're sharing, don't tell everyone everything that you're going through, and that don't share everything with anyone. You need to be able to kind of interview people or just have better judgment when it comes to who you share things with. But be conscious of what you let into your life, mind, heart, and time. I think in an age where social media is dominating, where you're scrolling up on a timeline and you're seeing a million different things, we're so saturated with sometimes these motivational talks. We're so saturated with people living a certain lifestyle. We're so saturated with, you know, depression and other forms of anxiety that we can't even process our own life because we're so busy looking at other people and we're so busy comparing ourselves to what other people are doing that we don't even take the time to really prioritize ourselves and focus on us and strategize for our own life. One thing that maybe is going to get on people's toes and is going to make people catch feelings, but unfollow those people who are not adding value to your life. I'm going to say it again. Unfollow people who are not adding value into your life. I had a changed perspective on this because I used to just add people for the sake of, you know, follow for follow back, and I'm just going to grow my followers. But let me be straight. I was following like 2,000 people on my podcast at one point. Actually, I still am. I need to delete some more people. But I was following, I think, on my personal. And like, I couldn't even see like the post that I wanted to see because it was so saturated with nonsense and garbage. If something or someone is not adding value to your life, then they're either not adding, like I said, or they're taking away. So there is no responsibility, or I owe no one the benefit of just following them for the sake of, oh, association, or I feel bad we went to high school, or, oh, we go to the same, you know, gym, or we go to the same church. No, be strategic about who you let into your life. Because just because someone can be a good person doesn't mean that they're going to be adding value to your life. And I know that sounds selfish, and I know that sounds like super like it's all about me, but Mahfouz, my boy, said it best. If you follow 2,000 people, imagine if 2,000 people were in this living room with me right now. I wouldn't be able to focus. You guys wouldn't be able to hear me, and I would be so distracted. I wouldn't be able to get my work done. So why do you think that having 2,000 followers on Instagram, especially filler pages and bot accounts and friends who are just so negative about life and not building you up or not adding anything to you, why do you think those people are not going to stress you out? Why do you think that's not going to give you anxiety and cause you just to drop lower than you already are? So be selective about what and who you let into your life. One thing that I really learned from this social media fast that I did recently was that I didn't need social media anymore. I actually valued one-on-one personal conversations with people. And I still do that today. Like someone came up to me today and they're like, yo, you haven't answered my call. And you haven't done this. I'm like, yo, I might be ghosting people and I might not be following up as much as I should have. But like I said, I think people catch feelings people catch digital and social feelings when it's like, nah, if you want to talk to me, let's meet up. Let's talk. Let's meet up when that time happens. Because someone told me once, why post everything about your life on Instagram? When you finally meet people in person, they already know everything that you're doing. So you have nothing to talk about anymore. I encourage you guys, if you can, do a social media fast. Take yourself off of socials and see how much you really need it. Because we become so dependent on it, and it becomes like, it's almost like a drug and just an addiction, rather than it's actually building me up. It's actually adding value to my life. Or maybe it's just for entertainment purposes only. We all have things we need to get done in life, and we all have passions and purposes. And I'm not saying that you can't enjoy things and have fun. But you sometimes have to do an audit, like my boy Mahfouz says, of what is good and what is bad. And is this really beneficial to my life? The Bible says, while all things are permissible, not all things are beneficial. Just because something's permissible doesn't mean you need to do it. So those are my 6 points for annihilating anxiety. Nothing super complex, just something practical and some things that, like I said, I've talked about with people before. But you guys need to be strategic about how you deal with the things in your life. And I called it annihilating anxiety because if anxiety is crippling us, why are we not doing something to fight the war against anxiety? If you are physically sick and you display certain symptoms that, you know, certain sicknesses would yield, what do? You take precautions, you take steps, you take medicine to heal yourself. I think a lot of times we think it's funny, or we think it's weird, or we think it's, you know, uncool to think about our mind that same way. But if your mind is stressing out, if your mind is sick, what are you doing to take care of your mind? What are you doing to take care of your mental health? And what steps are you taking to actually help you get out of that place of fear, get out of that place of anxiety and deal with it? If we can train our bodies physically and go to the gym, we need to be getting to the point where we can learn how to train our mind. And that's one of the points that I want to close off with. These aren't just points that you can use reactively in a situation, but you should be doing all 6 of these things proactively. You should be getting better sleep. You should be sharing and self-expressing yourself, even if you don't have anxiety. You should be selective within your sphere. You know, you should be taking care of yourself. All of these things that I said, you can do proactively beforehand, so that when these things come, when anxiety comes, when fear comes, because they will come, you will get scared. You will, you know, have moments where you're going to doubt. But if you set yourself up in a routine where you're taking care of you and you're taking steps to manage these things when they come up, then they're going to be much easier to deal with. So all this to say, you need to get serious about strategizing and coming up with a process to proactively deal with the things that come up in your life. And it's not always the big things. It's not always, oh, I'm going to be a valedictorian and I need to prepare my speech and I'm stressing out. Sometimes it's the little things. It's, you know, the little meetings here and there. It's the little presentations. It's, you know, that one PowerPoint you were asked to do and, you know, you're stressing about all the elements of creating it. Build yourself up in those little moments, because often those times will help you manifest and help you build in the bigger moments. So what I want you guys to take away from this is that these are practical steps that I use, that other people have used, that you can take to help you fight and deal with anxiety the right way. So I hope you guys enjoyed this video. It's not something I do often, but let me know if you guys want to see more of this type of content. I am planning to do more standalone stuff where it's just me talking. The anxiety in me right now is like, man, you got to prepare and plan and do all these things. But maybe that's just it. Maybe I'm just going to speak from the heart and kind of check in with you guys every so often. But if you guys want to see more videos like this, if you're on YouTube, give me a thumbs up, write something down in the comments. If you are on audio or listening to it on iTunes, Stitcher, Spotify, whatever, hit me up in the DM on Instagram or however you want to communicate to me. It's realcommunitytalks@gmail.com. Let me know if you guys want to see more content like this. I would love to create it. And if it helps you guys, because if it's not helping you guys, let me know. But if it helps you guys, let me know so I can continue to create content that you would enjoy and that could be useful to you. Thank you guys for tuning in. This is your host, Matt DeSilva, and I'm signing out.